Welcome to the first in a series of videos we here at Nanny have put together in order to enhance our extenders, our PAs, our MPs, and our nurses. Our mission here at Nanny is to treat patients with kidney disease in a very competent and compassionate fashion. Treating patients with kidney disease is a team sport. We realize that. And the extenders are a very vital part of our team. So this first lecture is on acid-base. Now, please stick with me. This is a very complex lecture. I realize that. Acid-base is one of the more complex areas of nephrology. And I kind of wish I would not have started with acid-base, but started with a simpler concept. But it is what it is. So here, please enjoy this video. Sit back. You may need to watch it once or twice, but if you can understand and grasp this lecture, you can get anything. So enjoy. Now, when I think about acid-base problems, the main issue is this: hydrogen. Hydrogen is a bad actor. It destroys all kinds of metabolic processes. It attaches to proteins and changes their shape. So hydrogen has to be controlled very diligently in the human body. Any fluid electrolyte problem in general, I like to think of it this way. Instead of a patient, which has a lot of other problems and tubes and lines and alarms going off, I like to think of acid-base problems like this: a beaker of water. And that beaker of water could be your bloodstream. In 1 liter of your blood, or in 1 beaker of water, 1 liter, you have hydrogen. How much hydrogen do you have? Well, not very much. I'm just going to draw a couple. How much do you have in there? You have 0.0 millimoles. Per liter of water. Just not very much. If you take tap water and were to count the hydrogen there, you're going to have 0.00004 millimoles per liter. By the way, I did the math, and if all the humans in the United States were molecules of water, 691 of them would be hydrogen. So we don't have very much hydrogen in our bloodstream, but we also don't tolerate very much hydrogen in our bloodstream. If you were to take a dropper and add 1 drop of hydrochloric acid in here, you're going to go from 0.00004 to 0.0009 millimoles, so you're adding a little more hydrogen, but your pH would go from 7.4 to 2.1, and you would pass away at about 6. I've never seen a pH less than about 6.2 survive. So it's very, very deadly to have these free-floating hydrogens. Yet, in all of our cells, metabolism is making hydrogen all day long. We're pumping hydrogen into our bloodstream, and we're eating hydrogen. It's in our diet. It's basically in the proteins we eat are loaded with hydrogen in the form of amino acids. So, if we're pumping hydrogen into the system, and we know the system can accept hydrogen, what do we do? What we do is we depend on a beautiful little trick invented by God. As soon as a hydrogen is seen in our bloodstream, we take a bicarbonate and we convert it into water. This is a beautiful reaction. This stuff is like gold to the human body. The bicarbonate will soak up the hydrogen, keeping it at a very, very low level. I think of bicarbonate like a security guard, and hydrogens, like, think of this as a party going on in here. And in that party are these hydrogen molecules, and they are bad kids. They were brought to the party, they're tearing things up, they're knocking over tables, they're pushing people around, they're just creating all kinds of havoc. Well, our body has bicarbonate security guards that will trap these hydrogens and escort them out of the party in the form of CO2. So, if we have a 0.00, then everything is fine. But if we go to 0.00000005, the bicarbonate will understand that we have an extra hydrogen there, and it will escort it out of the party, putting us back to 0.004. But we are down 1 bicarbonate. And by the way, I'm tired of writing all these zeros. So, we don't have to. If we take a little mathematic trick and take the negative log of the hydrogen ion concentration, what we get equals 7.4. Is this little trick, all it does, all the logarithmic scale does, is take numbers that are hard to write because of the number of zeros there and convert it to something that's much easier to write, 7.4. So I'm going to clean this up a little bit. But as soon as the hydrogen gets pumped in, we have bicarbonate. Combined to form plus CO2. So this is a bad kid brought to the party destroying things. This is the security guard escorting the kid out of the party. We lose the security guard every time. Well, we have this other wonderful system called the kidney. And the kidney's watching that. It's watching the number of bicarbonate in our bloodstream. And when it sees the bicarbonate start to drop, it will release more bicarbonate into the system. It actually makes bicarbonate. It redeploys more bicarbonate in here. They get soaked up by the hydrogen. So if we're eating acid and we're producing acid, it's being taken out of the party by the bicarbonate. Everything is fine as long as we pump more bicarbonate back into the system. How much bicarbonate do we need a day? Well, we will need about 50 milliequivalents. What's so important about that number is if you look at an amp of sodium bicarbonate, it is about 50 milliequivalents. The reason they do it that way is we need a normal human in health will need about 50 milliequivalents of bicarbonate to soak up about 50 milliequivalents of acid that we either eat or produce through metabolism to keep even. By the way, when you look at my dialysis patients who basically have no kidney function, they can't produce bicarbonate. So when they leave the dialysis unit, their bicarbonate, we make it about 35. They have about 35 milliequivalents of bicarbonate in their bloodstream. But because they're going to eat hydrogen and because they're going to, through metabolism, secrete bicarbonate into their bloodstream, it's going to start to fall. And on the next day, the non-dialysis day, it may be down to 25. And when they come into the dialysis unit 2 days later, it may be down to 15. If you wanted to keep them even, you would have to give them an amp of bicarbonate every day just to keep them at 25. Now, I'm going to clean this up again. And I'm going to again draw my liter of water again. Let's fill the beaker with water. And we know there's a little bit of hydrogen in there in a normal human. And we know their cells are going to be pumping hydrogen in there through metabolism. And we're going to be eating some hydrogen. And we know our body can't tolerate that hydrogen. So let's draw it this way. There's a security guard. And here's the water plus CO2. Now think of it this way. This is a teeter-totter. Or if you're from across the pond, I think they call it a seesaw. And on one side is bicarbonate, on the other side is CO2. And I'm going to put a little indicator here. And I'm going to put a scale up here. And on that scale, here's 7.4. Here is 7.37. 7.1, 7.0. Here's 7.5, 7.6, 7.7, 7.8. This is a hydrogen ion concentration. And here's our indicator where you write it 7.4. Now, with this system, you can have different problems. If your CO2 gets too high, this becomes heavy and the whole thing tilts that way, tilts to the right, and the pH starts to drop. So the CO2 rises, causes this side to become heavier than this side. If nothing else changes, you're going to start dropping the pH. That's called a respiratory, because of CO2, acidosis. If the CO2, let me put some numbers here too, by the way. Normal CO2 should be about 40. So if the CO2 goes up to 50, this side comes too heavy, this thing tilts this way, and you become a respiratory acidosis as your pH starts to drop. Now, what if instead of 40, we breathe very fast and it drops to 30? Instead of 40, it's now 30. This side here becomes too light. If nothing changes over here, the seesaw tips to the left and we start to get a alkalosis. And that's a respiratory alkalosis. So let's put this back to 40, where it should be. At 40, and when this is at 25, which are normal bicarbonate and normal CO2, then we're right there at 7.4. But what happens if our bicarbonate increases? And there's a lot of reasons your bicarbonate can increase. Let's say it's 35 instead of 25. This side becomes too heavy, and the seesaw tips to the left, and we start getting a down into 7.7, we start getting a metabolic alkalosis. Our blood becomes too alkali, or the opposite. Instead of 25, let's make it 15. We've lost bicarbonate. And you, for instance, you can lose bicarbonate in diarrhea. It's, your stool is full of bicarbonate. So if you have heavy diarrhea, you will lose bicarbonate, and you can get your bicarbonate down to, say, 15. At that point inside, this becomes too light, this side, and the seesaw will tip to the left, to the right, and we can start to draw the pH, and that's the metabolic acidosis. And we're going to talk about each one of these. By the way, you can have two problems at the same time. For the only two problems you can't have, you cannot have a respiratory alkalosis and a respiratory acidosis. You can't have your CO2 be too high and too low at the same time. But you could, for instance, have a respiratory acidosis where your CO2 is too high and you're tilting to the right. And you could have a metabolic acidosis where you've lost bicarbonate and you're too light on this side, and then it's a double whammy. You're really going to tilt to the right because you have two problems causing the seesaw to tip to the right. And stick with me for just for a minute, because I'm going to go over all this in a real simple five-step process to understand what's going on. And the first step is real simple. It's just to find out where this is pointed. Just look at the pH. So that's the respiratory acidosis, respiratory alkalosis, metabolic alkalosis, and metabolic acidosis. Those are the four primary problems. Now, draw the kidney here, pumping bicarbonate in as fast as we use it up, hopefully. You have this process called compensation. And what it means is, so let's give them a respiratory acidosis. The CO2 climb, so we're up in here into the 50 range, too heavy on that side, we tip this way, and now the pH, instead of being here, because of the weight of the CO2 on the seesaw, we're going to start to go down here to say 7.1 as we tip that way. Our body doesn't like that. So we have what's called compensation. Compensation says if the CO2 is too high, we better bring the bicarb up. What it does is if this side is too heavy, we better put more bicarbonate on this side to make this side more heavy to kind of equal things out. So it sends a signal to the kidney and the kidney starts making more bicarbonate. The problem is this may take a day or two for the kidney to make enough bicarbonate to level this seesaw back out. And even then, it never becomes totally level. Compensation is never 100%. We'll never get it back to we'll never get our pH back to 7.4 by adding more bicarbonate to this side. It just doesn't happen. So every one of these problems has a little bit of compensation built in so that given time, we can mitigate or have the problem be, instead of 7.1, we're probably going to be 7.3, which is still better. And again, it'll correct, but it'll never be normal. It'll never get back to 7.4. As a matter of fact, if it does get back to 7.4, you have another problem. And so we'll talk about that when we do the examples about compensation and overcompensation and what that means. So now I want to clean the board up here for just a second. Now I want to go through the individual problems: metabolic acidosis, respiratory acidosis, respiratory alkalosis, and metabolic alkalosis. And I'm going to start with the metabolic acidosis. And to be honest with you, the respiratory alkalosis and respiratory acidosis are pretty easy. If they're breathing too much, slow their breathing down. If they're breathing too little, speed their breathing up. That's about all you can say. But with the metabolic acidosis, it becomes much more problematic. And first of all, it's much more dangerous. It's also much more common. Now I want to go through the different problems and talk about the disease states that causes them. I'm going to start with metabolic acidosis because it is the more common one, and it also is the more dangerous one, and it's more complex because it has so many different variabilities to it, or different disease processes that cause it. But what it is we're getting too much hydrogen into the system, so much so that the bicarbonate is having trouble keeping up in escorting them out of the party. In other words, the bicarbonate is dropping, but we're not getting enough bicarbonate regenerated from the kidney to keep up with all these hydrogens produced. So where do these hydrogens come from? I've actually oversimplified this a little bit, because what I don't show you is, first of all, for every positive charge in this system, there is a negative charge. We humans do not carry a charge. If we did carry a charge, when we went to urinate, our urine would ground out and we would get shocked. That doesn't happen, because all of our positive charges equal all of our negative charges. And hydrogens just didn't get here by themselves. I don't think hydrogens can even drive. So somehow these bad hydrogen kids got to the party. Somebody brought them. Well, who brought them? I can tell you who brought them. Their mom. And their mom's name is Anne. Last name Ion. Anne Ion brought these kids to the party, and then, like any bad mom, she separated from them, let them alone. They're doing the bad things they do, and then she goes over here, probably at the bar, drinking, leaving the kids alone. So every of these metabolic acidosis somewhere has a particle, a negative charged particle, that brought them to the party. It can be an anion or that we didn't measure, or it can be an anion that we will measure, and I'll explain that in a minute, called chloride. So let's talk about, and this is where you get your gap versus non-gap. Depending on what acid brought them to the party, or what anion brought them to the party, gives us a clue on why we have the acidosis, where this hydrogen came from. So in the gap acidosis, you take the positive, we know they're equal, you take the positive minus the bicarbonate, which is a minus, and the chloride, which is a minus. So now we know that the positive charges equal the negative charges, so when you subtract the two, you should get zero. So if you have 140 here, which is typical, you have 25, which is typical, and 105, which is normal, then I subtract these, I'm not getting zero, I'm getting 10. What that means is the normal gap is 10. When you measure the bloodstream, when you measure these different elements in the bloodstream, what you're saying is, in a normal individual, we have about 10 of these negative charged particles that brought an acid to the party. That's okay. Our body expects that. We can handle about 10 of these bad moms. But when you start to see this number goes, for instance, to 30, that means there was a lot more of these bad moms that brought their bad kid to the party. And we see that by the fact that the pH dropped and the bicarbonate dropped, the security guard, because it did escort some of these out of the party. So when you see the bicarbonate is low, the pH is low, and the gap is high, you know something brought these hydrogens to the party. So what can bring these things to the party? Well, it's actually a fairly limited number of things. When I was a medical student, we talked about mule pack. But now I notice most medical schools and students are talking about mud piles. And this stands for methanol, uremia, I'll explain all these in a minute, DKA, peraldehyde, inborn errors of metabolism, which just means something happened genetically and they're making too much of an acid. I'm going to forget these two because you never see them anymore. Lactate, you see commonly. Ethylene glycol, you only see in suicide attempts. And salicylate, again, you probably only see in suicide attempts. So these all have in common one thing. They have a negative charged anion and a positive charged hydrogen. When they get into the bloodstream, the hydrogen gets soaked up by the bicarbonate, and we're stuck with this negative charged anion, which we don't measure. So we go 140 minus 25, and then this is probably going to be down to about 90, because the rest of the negatives are these things, but we're not going to count them. So your gap goes higher. It's not because you actually have a charge in your body, because for every one of these, there's a sodium. It's because we didn't count these. They're too expensive to count. It's easy to count bicarbonate and chloride and sodium, so those are what we count. And when we see the number go elevated, we just know there's more of these negatively charged particles. So let's talk about those. Methanol. And we're going to give you some clues to methanol intoxication that you'll often see on board tests. And actually, you do actually see these in the ER or in patients. Methanol is an alcohol usually used by alcoholics who can't have access to ethanol. They will switch and drink methanol. It's got a sweet taste to it. The clues are that it does cause a rip-roaring acidosis because it is an acid. It does cause low bicarbonate because it is an acid. The bicarbonate soak it up. And then we're stuck with this negative charged moiety that is the methanol moiety. We don't measure it. The other clue is this methanol, when it gets metabolized, is often on board test, it causes blindness or it causes visual changes. I don't understand it. I don't know why. I just know that when you find somebody down on the ground, usually an alcoholic, with a rip-roaring acidosis, the pH is down in this range, the 7.1 range, they have a large gap, you got to think about methanol, particularly if they can't see. Uremia is a tough one. Uremia is this. You don't have a kidney. Your body makes all kinds of, I call it gunk. It makes all kinds of things. So I once saw a list of all the things, bad stuff that humans make in their cells. All the byproducts, the products of metabolism. For instance, BUN, creatinine, ... The list was over 1,000 items long. Your body makes over 1,000 different toxins. A lot of those toxins are acids, like sulfuric acids and phosphoric acids and fluorinic acid. There's all these acids that your body makes. This is the particle, the negative particle. The acid, the hydrogen, was taken care of by the bicarbonate, but we don't have a way to take care of all those other negative charges. They start to accumulate and they raise the gap because we're not measuring them. So uremia is just a kidney patient, usually a dialysis patient, someone with advanced kidney disease, that the kidney is so bad they can't get rid of, because normally your kidney would get rid of this stuff. DKA is interesting. DKA is this here. You have cells, all of your cells, what they do is they take in glucose and they take in oxygen and they kick out CO2 and they kick out energy. Okay, normal good system. Glucose, in order to get into the cell in the first place, needs insulin. I think of insulin as a gatekeeper. Insulin opens the door, glucose goes into the cell. Insulin closes the door, glucose doesn't go into the cell. So in somebody who's diabetic and doesn't have, these are type 1 diabetics, by the way. You never see it in type 2 diabetics. It's always type 1. When you have a type 1 diabetic, there's no insulin to open the door. The blood sugar on the outside of the blood cell, in the bloodstream, maybe 1,200, 1,400. I've seen them both. It gets really, really high because it can't get into the cell. Yet it still has so much sugar, it can't get in. Your body has a backup system. God designed a system that if we can't get sugar into the cell can switch over and start to burn fat, fatty acids. Unfortunately, when you burn fatty acids, you do get energy, so it's a backup system, but you don't get CO2. Instead, you get ketones. Ketones are these negative charged particles. They were keto acids. They were like with that. The acid got split off, taken care of by the bicarbonate, and now we're stuck with the ketone, which raises the gap because we don't measure ketones. Again, we're not going to talk about these two. Lactate is the exact same thing as this, but instead of glucose not getting it, it's usually oxygen. For whatever reason, the cardiac output drops due to a big heart attack or a suffocation or a limb clots off. Whatever happens with ischemia, you don't have oxygen. The cell can't survive. It may have sugar, but now it doesn't have the oxygen. And it switches over and is burning fats. But instead of getting ketones in that case, we're starting to get lactate. So lactate's the negative part. This is lactic acid. The hydrogen gets escorted out by the bicarbonate, and we're stuck with the lactate. And the lactate is over here, not getting counted. And so it raises the gap. This is usually due to ischemia of something, somewhere. Ethylene glycol is another toxic ingestion, usually a suicide attempt, and it is an acid. So you have the ethylene acid. Hydrogen gets soaked up by the bicarbonate, and we're stuck with the ethylene glycol moiety that we're not counting. What you'll see here is usually a suicide attempt. They're on board tests. They're always found on the floor of a garage with a liquid surrounding them. And what it is they drank ethylene glycol. The clues are, besides a suicide attempt, is that when they manufacture ethylene glycol, because it is used in antifreeze, they put a fluorescent dye in it. And they do that because if you have a radiator leak, the mechanic can just shine ultraviolet light along your radiator path and find out where the leak is by looking where the fluorescent dye is coming out. Well, you can use that to your advantage. If they're making urine, the fluorescent dye comes out in the urine, so the board question will say their urine would glow under ultraviolet light, or a Wood's lamp, which is a way of looking at the urine under ultraviolet light. It glows because of the fluorescent dye in it. The other common scenario you see on board tests is that when ethylene glycol gets metabolized, and I don't know the whole process of how it gets metabolized, all I know is it does cause oxalate stones to form. So they get oxalate stones in their kidney or oxalate crystals in their blood. It's a sign of ethylene glycol. So when you see a rip-roaring acidosis with the pH being down in this range, 7.1 or so, and you see the bicarbonate's really low, and you see the gap is really high, and you go through your mud piles algorithm, and then you say that their urine's glowing and they got oxalate crystals in their urine, you know it's ethylene glycol. And then you start the treatment for ethylene glycol, which is different than the treatment for lactic acid, which is different from the treatment for DKA. And finally, there's salicylic acid, which is aspirin. And with aspirin, again, it's usually a suicide. It's not a small amount of aspirin. It has to be a large amount of aspirin taken with a very fast metabolism. That aspirin is like this. It's a negative charge particle and a hydrogen, with the hydrogen being taken away. And so what we're seeing is what's left is the aspirin moiety. Now, let me clean this up. And we'll talk about the non-GAP acidosis. The non-GAP acidosis is very, very similar to the GAP acidosis. And let me clean this up a little bit. The difference between the non-GAP acidosis and the GAP acidosis is what anion brought the hydrogen to the party. If you remember, in the GAP acidosis, it was an anion of the mud piles fashion, but in the non-GAP acidosis, it's much more simple. Hydrochloric acid. It's the chloride that brought the hydrogen to the party, and then the chloride splits off. But the difference between the chloride And the gap acidosis is we do measure chloride. So when we do our little analysis of sodium, the positive charge, minus the negative charges, in this case, the negative charge does get measured, plus the bicarbonate, does get measured. So the gap is still going to be about 10, which is normal. And the non-gap metabolic acidosis is pretty simple because there's really just two processes that cause it. One of them is diarrhea. And in diarrhea, because your stool has so much bicarbonate in it, that you lose the bicarbonate, this side of the seesaw gets too light, this doesn't change, and the meter reads an acidosis because of the loss of bicarbonate from the diarrhea stool. The other causes, probably the more common one, are called renal tubular acidoses, and there's three types, and we'll go through those. And in this process, it's the opposite. It's the kidney can't generate the bicarbonate the bicarbonate's being used up, soaking up these hydrogens that your body's making. In renal tubular acidosis, the kidney loses the ability to regenerate our security guard bicarbonates. And it comes in three flavors. 1, 2, and 4. Forgive me, I didn't do this system. I didn't design it this way. It's the way I learned it, though. 1, 2, and 4. At the level that you're at, it probably doesn't matter that you understand the difference between type 1, 2, and 4. Type 1 is where the distal tubule can't regenerate bicarbonate. Type 2 is where the proximal tubule can't absorb bicarbonate, but either way is you're losing bicarbonate. And then type 4 is by far the most common. Type 4 you probably do need to know because it's so common. Type 4 RTA, it's a non-gap metabolic acidosis. The pH is low because it's an acidosis, and the other name for it is hyporeninemic hypoaldosteronism. What it is the kidney loses ability to respond to aldosterone, and aldosterone, if you remember, is what reabsorbs sodium and causes and releases potassium into the urine stream. Why this is important is because it's very common in diabetes. You see it a lot in diabetics, particularly late-stage diabetics. They start to become acidemic. They start to have acid in their blood. And it's simply because the kidney can't get rid of the acid, and the acid accumulates, the bicarbonate falls, and so it's common with an type 4 RTA is just basically diabetes. About probably a third of diabetics in the later stage of the diabetic disease will get an acidosis. So that's the important one. The treatment for all the acidosis, whether it be GAP or non-GAP, are basically the same. You've got to restore the bicarbonate, either in an oral pill if they're an outpatient, or an IV form of sodium bicarbonate if they're an inpatient, and then try to stop whatever process is causing it. If it is a GAP acidosis, you've got to reverse whatever one of the mud pile disease processes is going on. If it's a non-GAP acidosis, you've got to try to reverse whatever is causing the non-GAP acidosis. The diarrhea would be the common one, or the treat the diabetic diabetes very diligently. Now, I want to go through some examples, true patient examples of these acidoses. Okay, here we go. I've redrawn this, so here's our liter of water or liter of blood. And again, we have the hydrogens coming in, either we're eating them or our cells are producing them. We have the anion that brought the hydrogen to the party and then disassociated, which either chloride or one of the anions we're not going to measure. We have the bicarbonate being regenerated by the kidney as fast as it gets used up here, hopefully. So I want to go through a 5-step process that can help us decide what acid-base disorder is there so we can start to treat it. So, The first step is simple. The first step is, which need to know, is it an acid problem or a base problem? And again, it's just looking at this, is the meters more than 7.3, 7.2, 7.1, that's an acidosis or an alkalosis. So that's easy. Step two is also easy. If you think about it, there are two ways that this CO2 can be a problem. If we don't breathe enough, then this CO2 starts to accumulate, it gets heavy, this side drops, and we become acidemic, and that's a respiratory acidosis. If we breathe too much, this CO2 becomes too light, and there's less pressure on this side, and it tips this way, and we become alkalosis. It's a respiratory alkalosis. And then on the bicarbonate side, the metabolic side, if we have too much bicarbonate, for whatever reason, the kidney produces too much bicarbonate, then we tip this way, and we become alkalemic, and that's a metabolic alkalosis. And if we have too little bicarbonate, this side becomes light, and the CO2, which doesn't change, pushes down here, and we become acidemic, and that's a metabolic alkalosis. So it's really only four issues. It's two respiratory and two metabolic. So what we have to do at this step is decide, is this going to be a metabolic issue or a respiratory issue? And the way you do that is you look at the CO2 and the bicarbonate. One of them or both of them are going to be off. Now, in reality, they're probably both going to be off because of compensation and because there could be two problems going on. But what you're looking for is the one that's off that would lead to whichever way this is pointing. So if this is pointing to the acid, if it's pointing here to an acid side, and that would be either the CO2 is too heavy or the bicarbonate is too light. And so that'll help point to which one it is. So in your mind, as you're doing these problems, just picture, is the CO2 too heavy or the bicarbonate too light if we're on the acid side? If we're on the basic side, if the arrow's pointing over here, then either the bicarbonate is too heavy or the CO2 is too light. And you'll see this as we go through the problems. Three is, look at the gap. If it's an acidosis, then the problem with an acidosis is all these hydrogens are alike. So how do you know what caused the acidosis? Well, what you do is you look at what anion brought the hydrogen to the party, because the anions are still going to be there. The hydrogens are probably going to be gone because the bicarbonate escorted them out of the party. But as the investigator, you're going to say, okay, well, we don't see the hydrogen, but what we do see is something that brought the hydrogen to the party. It's going to be an anion. It's either going to be an anion that we didn't measure, which is going to give us a gap, or it's going to be an anion we measured, which is going to give us a non-gap, and I'll show you that step. The fourth step is compensation. And I'll show you a real simple way. As I said before, if we become alkalemic, if the arrow starts pointing over here, our body doesn't like it and attempts to bring it back by throwing in the opposite air. So if this side is too heavy, too much CO2, a respiratory acidosis, and we tip this way, what we do tend to get is a metabolic alkalosis by the kidney bringing up the bicarbonate to bring this side back down, to bring us back towards even. And there's a certain amount that should happen. If it happens more than that certain amount, well, I'll show you how to do that, then we actually have two issues. We have a metabolic acidosis and the respiratory alkalosis. Honestly, step four may not be important for most of what you're doing. Unless you're a nephrologist or an intensive care doctor, compensation is not that important for what you're doing. What's most important is you identify whether it's an acid or a base problem, and whether it's metabolic or whether it's respiratory, and whether if it's an acidosis, what if it's a gap or a non-gap. That will get you 99% of the way to treating the main problem. Now, as an additional issue, if you want to go a step further, you can go and say, okay, is there compensation? Did the body do what it should do? And then step five, I'm going to tell you about what you would almost never do unless you were a nephrologist, because it's real nerdy. And that's to say whether there's two or three issues going on at the same time. And it's called a gap analysis or a delta gap analysis. I'm not going to go too much into it, but it just basically says, is there a second problem here? So let's go through some real-world examples. Let's go through problem number one. Problem number one is a 24-year-old found down in the park. Medics called, took her to the ER. She's obtunded with pinpoint pupils. Her opening labs show that she has an O2 saturation on room air of 88%, a little bit low. Her ABG, and ABGs are always written throughout the nation, they're written like this, with the pH first, the CO2 second, and the O2 third. So it's 7.25, 60 of the CO2, and her O2 is 65. Then the electrolyte profile is a sodium, they're always written this way, sodium, potassium, chloride bicarbonate, BUN, and creatinine. A lot of times you'll see it written this way, it's called a fishbone pattern. And you put the two positive charges, the sodium, 137, potassium, 4.5. And then you put the two negative charges, which is a chloride, 100, and the bicarbonate, 26. And then you put the BUN and creatinine. Again, this is kind of a national standard. You don't see it as much anymore because with EMRs, they have a hard time doing this. But this is a shorthand way of writing it without having to write all the labels. And then the glucose is always written here. We'll just give her 100. Okay? So there's our patient. There's the problem. Let's just go through here. Step one. And in your mind, picture this. Picture this seesaw with the bicarb with a normal CO2 is 40 and a normal bicarbonate is 25. And if that is the case, which it usually is in health, then the pH is going to be balanced at 7.4. But what's wrong here? She has an acidosis. Her meter is not here. It is over here. She's at 7.2. The seesaw has tilted this way down to the right. It's gone down to the right. So, is an acidosis or alkalosis? Well, obviously, it's an acidosis. That's number one. Number two, is it metabolic or respiratory? Well, when you evaluate that, it may be the case that both the CO2, which is a respiratory system, and the bicarbonate are both going to be off. But only one of them is going to cause this acidosis. Her CO2 should be 40, but her CO2 is, what did we see it was? Her CO2 on the blood gas was 60. It's way up here. It's a lot heavier pushing down on this side, which would indeed make this scale tip to the right and bring the meter down to 7.2. So we know that it is a respiratory problem. It's not a metabolic. As a matter of fact, her metabolic problem, a normal bicarbonate is 25 and hers is already 26. It hasn't changed hardly at all. So we know it's a respiratory acidosis. With this, you don't need to do that. You can do the gap if you want, but because it's an alkalosis, it's a respiratory problem, there probably shouldn't be a gap. And there isn't. It's 126, the negative charges, minus the positive charge, 137. It's 11. The gap is 11, which is normal. Anything up to about 12 is normal. Now, compensation. As I said, if the meter is down into this range, your body doesn't like that. If the CO2 is too high because she's not breathing well, this side gets too heavy and it drops. Your body will naturally try to make this side heavier. It's like having a overweight child on this side. You better put an overweight child on this side too to balance it out. Well, your kidney does that. It does not like to have this pH down into this range. So what it does is it pumps out more bicarbonate and it should bring this 25 up to maybe 30, 35. How much? Well, it's 0.3 times the change in the respiratory problem. So the change from 40 to 60 is 20. So 0.3 times 20 is 6. The CO2 should be 31. Matter of fact, if the CO2 were 31, this side would start to tilt back to the left and the meter would approach back to normality. But it hasn't. The CO2 is unchanged. So what that means is it's uncompensated. This is a non-compensated respiratory acidosis. And that's kind of what you would expect, by the way. That does tell you one piece of information. This probably happened pretty quickly. It takes about 24 to 48 hours for the kidney to generate enough bicarbonate to bring this back to fully compensation. And because it has not compensated at all, we know this is a pure respiratory acidosis, and it probably happened within the last 12 to 24 hours because there's no compensation. No reason to check the gap, so it's already 11, and the delta gap is ridiculous. The only one who would ever do that would be a nephrologist. So that's case one. Now, let's go to case two. Let me clean this back up. This is a 60-year-old male with ALS brought to the ER. Family's concerned he's more somnolent than usual. He reports a morning headache, not feeling refreshed after a night's sleep, which is unusual for him. His ABG shows that he has a pH of 7.3. He's got a PCO2 of 57 and an O2 of 70. And his basic metabolic profile shows a sodium 142, which is normal, potassium 4.0, which is normal, chloride 110, which is normal, bicarbonate 32, which is high, then the butane and creatinine are normal. So, step one, is it an acidosis or an alkalosis? Well, pH is 7.3. This is not here. It's here. It's too low. It's 7.3. So he has an acidosis. So we know it's an acidosis. Step two, is it metabolic or respiratory? Well, we know that CO2 normal is 40, but his CO2 is 57. It should be pushing this way. That's probably the cause, making this side too heavy. And then let's look at the bicarbonate, which is 32. It should be 25, but it's 32. If that were the problem, if it were a metabolic problem, and just a metabolic problem, the meter would have swung this way and it would have been an alkalosis, but it's not. So this says it's a respiratory problem. The CO2 is too high, so it's a respiratory problem. Again, is there a gap? Well, see, 110, 142. Nope, the gap is zero, so there's no gap at all. But you don't need to do that because it's a respiratory problem anyways, but it's a respiratory acidosis. Now, compensation. Again, if it's a respiratory problem, 0.3 times the change in the CO2 should equal the change in the bicarb. So, 0.3, see, change in the CO2 is 17. So, 17 times 0.3 is about 31. Yep, he's compensated. So, what happened was this gentleman, presumably because of his ALS, is not breathing very well. His muscle is... muscles of respiration are weak. He's not breathing very well. The CO2 climbs, putting weight on this side, drawing the meter over here to an acidosis. But it must have been going on for a long period of time, over 24 to 48 hours, because the kidney did have time to regenerate more bicarbonate, putting more weight on this side. So this is a compensated respiratory acidosis. The first case was an uncompensated respiratory acidosis. Same problem, too much CO2. In the first case, this did not correct because it didn't have time to correct. In this case, it's a long-term problem. ALS is a chronic problem, is that they did have time, the kidney did have time to correct and try to bring this back. Matter of fact, if this hadn't happened, then if this was still 25, you know that pH is going to be like the first case, back into the 7.1 range. So the body did what it should do and made this side heavier. By the way I remember these numbers, I just remember 0.3, 0.6 and 1.2 is, first of all, they're all double of each other, but also that this, they're in the reverse order. of how bad they are for the human. Respiratory problems are not that bad for a human, and so it's probably the most minor compensation is needed. Metabolic acidosis by far is the worst thing you can have because it gets so bad, it's actually quite deadly, and that's why you have the highest level of compensation. So it goes respiratory, metabolic alkalosis, which is not that bad. I don't think I've ever seen anybody die from respiratory alkalosis. I have seen people die from metabolic acidosis. So this is how you remember, 0.3, double it to 0.6, double it to 1.2. Okay. In this next case, we have a 45-year-old male, known drug abuser, comes to the ER with shortness of breath. The O2 saturation, 99%. He's obviously tachypneic, Kussmaul respirations. ABG, 6.95. We better put that in there. It's not here. Actually, it's almost off the scale. Very acidemic. They've blown their CO2 off from 40 down to 9. Now, their base metabolic profile shows that the bicarbonate is down to 2. They've got the bicarbonate down to 2. So, step one, acidosis or alkalosis? Well, obviously, this is an acidosis. Step two, metabolic or respiratory? Well, if it were respiratory, the CO2 would be higher. It's actually lower. They brought their CO2 from 40 down to 9. That would, if nothing else, that would swing the meter this way to the left. Instead, it went to the right. So that's not the problem. The bicarbonate, 25 down, there it goes, there's a problem, is this side is too light and the meter swung to the right. And we got the bicarbonate from 25 down to 2. So we know it's a metabolic acidosis. Well, here we better check the gap. So the gap is, let's see, what, 98 as 100. So 130 minus 100 is 30. The gap equals 30. It's the positive charges, 130 minus the two negative charges, 98 and 2. The gap is 30. Normals, just so you know, is I'm going to put 10. So the gap is 20. That means is there's 20 of these things right here that shouldn't be there. Normally you have 10 there. We have 30, but 10 are normal, so we know that 20 more of these things are here. 20 more of these things brought their hydrogen to the party and titrated down the bicarbonate security guards. So we have a gap acidosis, metabolic acidosis. Now we've got to go through our mud piles. To decide what is it, what acid is it, what anion brought that hydrogen to the party. Now, let's look at compensation. Well, we know for a metabolic acidosis, 1.2 times the change should equal the other change. So 1.2, see the change in the bicarbonate is 25, 24, 23. So it's 23 times 1.22 should give us about, I'm going to say 27. So the 40 should have dropped by 27 to about 13. In other words, because the bicarbonate dropped, you start breathing faster to get the CO2 to drop to level the seesaw back out. If you're lightening up this side because of lack of bicarbonate, you're going to lighten up this side with increased respiration, so this levels out, and this should go to about 13 or so. But it didn't. It went down to 9. So what happened is they actually have two problems here. They overcompensated. They breathed down as much as they could, and they kept on going down to about 9. It should be 13. It's down to 9 because 1.2 times the change in bicarb should equal 13. It equals 9. They've overbreathed. So they have also, in addition to the gap metabolic acidosis, they have a respiratory alkalosis hidden within that. So the gap's probably not important here. So what we know is that one of these here brought a hydrogen to the party. Which anion was it? Well, we'll have to go through doing probably some more lab tests and some more investigation. It was either methanol. They drank methanol. They have uremia. They don't, because we know we were given the BUN and creatinine here. They're normal, so they don't have uremia. DKA, diabetic ketoacidosis. Well, we don't know they're diabetic, so we better check, but I doubt they're diabetic. Peraldehyde and inborn error metabolism. Again, we're crossing those off the list. Lactate's a big one. We better measure a serum lactate. Ethylene glycol, again, big. Drug abusers, maybe got depressed, decided to drink ethylene glycol. That can cause this picture. And salicylates can cause this picture. So you'd send the lab a salicylate, ethylene glycol, a lactate. You would send ketones. And actually, in most hospitals, there's one panel that captures all those, if you want to get it, including the methanol. What I suspect happened is, since they're a drug abuser, they probably, and this is a common board question, I've just seen it several times on boards, and I've actually seen it a couple times in real life, is it's a salicylate intoxication. Because what salicylate does is it causes a marked gap acidosis, and that's what they have. The anion is the salicylate anion, and salicylates also cause increased breathing. It stimulates your aspirin, stimulates your respiratory center, and so they actually overbreathe. And that's what Kussmaul breathing is. When you usually see it with a severe metabolic acidosis, it's the body's attempt to lower the CO2 as much as possible to try to level out this seesaw. And then with the salicylates, they keep on breathing even more, and they overbreathe and get into a respiratory alkalosis pattern. So when you see respiratory alkalosis with a metabolic acidosis in a gap, it's usually a salicylate problem. Nice case. Okay, in this next case, is a 47-year-old male alcohol abuser, comes to the ER with severe abdominal pain, nausea, vomiting. On exam, blood pressure is 90 over 50, very tender abdomen. ABG shows that it's got a pH of 7.28 with a CO2 of 34, an O2 of 88. The BNP shows a sodium 132, potassium 4.0, normal. The chloride is 92. The bicarbonate is 16 with a BUN and creatinine of 45 and 1.5, a little elevated, so it's a little kidney disease going on. Amylase is 400 with lipase of 250, both fairly elevated. So, let's work through this problem. First step, acid or base. Again, 7.28 clearly it's an acidosis. Next step, was it metabolic or respiratory? Well, let's see. Let's put some numbers in here. The CO2 is 34. It's 34. It should be 40. It's dropped to 34. So they breathe their CO2 down to that. Wouldn't that actually, if this lightened up this side, if it went from 40 to 34, if nothing else changed, you would have an alkalosis, you have respiratory alkalosis. We don't have that, so it's probably not that. Let's look at the bicarbonate is 16. Instead of 25, it's dropped to 16. That would make this side too light, and you would tend to tip to the right, so that is it. So this is, again, a metabolic problem. The metabolic problem is what's causing the needle to go to that in the right direction to cause the acidosis. So it's a metabolic acidosis. The gap is, let's see, the two negative charges, 92 and 16, would be 108. So 132 minus 108 would be what, 24. The gap is 24. So the gap is 24. Let's just write that in there. Gap equals 24. Again, normal, let's say it's 10. So that means there's 14 more anions that shouldn't be there. It's 14 more of these brought acid to the party and then disassociated. So, back to mud piles. is a gap acidosis. So with gap acidosis, one of these has to be the etiology. Is there compensation? Well, with a metabolic acidosis, it's 1.2 times the change in the bicarbonate. I'm going to say that the change here from 25 down to 60, I'm going to say that's 10 just to make math easy. We've dropped bicarbonate by 10 points, so 10 times 1.2, we should have dropped the CO2 by 12 points. It should be 28. It's not, it's 34. So, again, I'm going to draw this out. 1.2 times the delta bicarb. And the delta bicarb is 10. Remember, it went from 25 down, say, 15 to 10. So that would be equal to 12. 12. That means that this, the CO2, should go down by 12 in order to lighten up this side. Which would be 28. So 40 minus 12 would be 28. The CO2 should equal, what, 28. But it doesn't. It equals 34. They didn't breathe enough. They really need to breathe from 34 on down to 28 in order to make this as back to normal as possible. So we know this is a dual disorder. There's a metabolic acidosis for sure, but there's also a respiratory acidosis because the CO2 should be 28, but it's 34. They're not breathing enough. So in this case, we got to figure out which one of these things that patient took. And again, that's where you would send the profile that would include the methanol. You know it's not uremia. These kidney numbers are, although not normal, these BUN and creatinine are not near high enough to cause uremia. So you know the gap metabolic acidosis is going to be one of these, so you need to send a methanol level. You're not uremic because this kidney dysfunction is not near bad enough to cause uremia. But I would probably rule out DKA by sending ketones. The formaldehyde and the inborn error metabolisms are non-events. Lactate certainly needs to be sent. Ethylene glycol certainly needs to be sent as a suicide attempt. And salicylates need to be sent. What I suspect, I don't have the answers for these, what I suspect is this probably is a ethylene glycol or a methanol intoxication. They do tend to depress respirations. So they got himself a metabolic acidosis of the gap type because of, for instance, methanol. They drank methanol, couldn't get alcohol, so they took methanol instead. And that did depress the respirations and they couldn't breathe fast enough to totally compensate. So it's really an uncompensated metabolic acidosis, which would be a metabolic acidosis with respiratory acidosis. So there you go. That brings us to the end. I know this is complex. Again, if you can understand acidosis, you could probably understand anything in nephrology. These are the more complex cases, but just remember the seesaw. Remember this, I'd say it's a three-step process. Forget the compensation, not that important for what you're doing. The gap is not that important. So just remember, see if there's an acidosis or an alkalosis. Is it metabolic or respiratory? By which one's causing the seesaw to tip the wrong way? And then is there a gap? And if there's a gap, then it's mud piles. If there's non-gap, then it is a kidney issue, almost always. Or it's due to a diarrhea where you're losing all your bicarbonate in your stool. So the bicarbonate goes low. And by the way, if this is a non-gap, say the gap was 10 here. We still have the metabolic acidosis, but with a 10 here, instead of mud piles, it's hard up. And that stands for hyperal. Hyperalimentation, because of the acid in the proteins they're giving you, can give you an acidosis, not that common. A is acetazolamide. And that's easy. Acetazolamide is a medication that causes you to waste bicarbonate. That's why you give it. You give it to cause somebody to have bicarbonate in their urine. It causes the kidney, instead of to reclaim bicarbonate, to actually spill bicarbonate. So it's acetazolamide that will cause a non-GAP metabolic acidosis. R is the most common one, renal tubular acidosis. And that's where, again, where the kidney is not getting rid of acid and instead getting rid of bicarbonate. It can't regenerate the bicarbonate and it's not getting rid of the acid. And there's three types, one, two, and don't ask me why, four. Just be aware they exist. Diarrhea, a big common one, because bicarbonate, your colon is full of bicarbonate, and if you have a lot of diarrhea, you're actually wasting the bicarbonate. The bicarbonate is not being used to escort hydrogen out of the party. Instead, the security guards are just being lost in the stool. And that causes a bad acidosis. And then these two, ureterosigmoid fistula and pancreatic fistula, again, just like in diarrhea, in some cases, the surgeon, the urologist will reroute the ureter coming out of the kidney into part of the colon, in order, so usually it's done, for instance, in paraplegics, instead of, who are always having problems with urinating on their skin. Instead, what you do is you put it into their colon, and then the colon out into a colostomy bag. So the colon, if you have a bladder cancer, for instance, you can take the bladder out and then make part of the colon, take the colon and make a bladder out of that, called a neobladder, out of the colon. Well, the problem is when you put urine into that part of the colon starts to spill bicarbonate, just like in diarrhea. It's not sure what's going on and it spills bicarbonate, so you're losing bicarbonate. So all these have one thing in common. You're losing bicarbonate somehow, or you're not getting rid of acid somehow. So that's hard up, and that's the metabolic acidosis of the non-GAP type, hard up. So the thing I need to remember, all acidoses are either mud piles or hard ups. Mud piles or hard up. Every acidosis is gonna fall into one of these. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. I'm gonna get rid of these two. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. There's really only 12 causes of any acidosis. It's either mud piles or it's hard up. So, thank you.